Okay, so I'll just talk about this a little bit as we're sort of waiting to navigate. So that piece is called Matching Drapes. It was a collaboration with a visual artist in Minneapolis named Terrence Payne. And Terrence Payne really works to create portraits that use a lot of patterns that sort of represent kind of characteristics. And one of the things that our works have in common is that we've got these sort of subversive embedded messaging that's sort of disrupting these sort of Victorian, I'll finish this thought, Victorian kind of pristine notions of formal versus the vernacular. And so those felt like a good, happy marriage in this piece, and I'll talk about that more.
Thank you. 5 minutes. I'm gonna just let the video play out and then I'm gonna blab a little bit more.
Shared space in a generative process for kind of finding common language. So interested in pattern and repetition and finding where those overlaps of expression and creativity exist. The visual artist for that piece was Jennifer Davis, and then the composer, Jeremy Lovesecker, was involved in that. Thanks so much, my 5 minutes are up.
Project that I'm going to spend most of the time on. These are small in scale, probably 16, 18 inches high, and I was thinking of them as kind of maquettes for something room size to partition, and then having some of the shadows and things being implied with color as opposed to light, and sort of thinking about that in relationship to photography and the way in which light is sort of applied to an object and freezes it in time and creates a specific condition. So like on that one, the large shadow you see is painted in. So I got really interested in that and sort of the position that these things may have held at one point that created the shadow, and then you know you give it full light and that condition is kind of gone. So you go to the next one. So these are a few works that will be in this project coming up. That I made based on that, where I sort of left the idea of these partitions and worked with these simple kind of crude 2x4 forms. And so on them, it's difficult to sort of tell. They're works that are really hard to photograph, which is like a really annoying thing artists say a lot. But it's true in the sense that the light on the sculptures in paint obeys the sort of condition that they're in. So the top planes of them, you can go to the next slide. The top, you can see this one's in progress. So that left side is actually being tinted with paint. And the two blocks that are coming out of the middle, the top one is painted, the bottom one is just the same color as everything else. So when they're completed, they obey the conditions that they would normally be in, and thus it's difficult to discern unless you're walking around it, whether it's just a blue, all the same color blue and the light's hitting it, or whether I've then gone through and kind of upped the contrast, basically. So you go to the next one. So these were for this project was at a place called Saladillas in San Antonio. It's a domestic space, quite small, and about 90 minutes from here. So you can go to the next slide. So I had the idea that I wanted to use this space as kind of a laboratory and workspace as well, and not just bring objects in and put them on the walls and the floor, So I started by buying some stuff in San Antonio at thrift stores and just moving it around the space. Go to the next slide. This was a bench that was sitting outside that I blocked the door with, and on the right side are all the shelves and kind of pedestal support material that the gallery has had historically. So I dragged those out of the closet, and I made images with my camera on my first trip. So I drove down there, and I spent the night in the space, woke up the next day, and worked in the space for 5 or 6 hours with these thrift store objects, kind of just as a way to begin this problem of what I was going to use. These are some objects from my studio that I brought in, and I started making photographs of them in the space. So that's one. The next one. That's an image of the same pieces where I've changed the position of the camera. And at the bottom, you can see this lasso rope that I bought at the thrift store. So I made a lot of images with the camera, came back to Austin, brought some of the images back, the works back to my studio, including the 2x4 sculpture I made in the studio, it came home. The yellow sheet I bought at the thrift store, put it in the space, made images with it, and brought it back. And so I started photographing the works in my studio again, now with this sort of detritus and this sort of memory of what was at Solidea's. So this is actually a photograph that I made in my studio and printed. Go to the next slide. And took back to Solidea's a second time. So I drove back, spent the night again, and on the right you can see that photograph on the wall. And then in the middle you can see the works themselves. And on the left you can see a similar situation. Photograph, sort of evidence or documentation. And then this is the next slide where I made photographs of those photographs. So now it's like this doubling effect. So this is the first actual work that was going to be included in the final presentation. It's a photograph. So go to the next one. This is the second actual work that would be in the show. So it's a photograph of the photograph pinned to the wall that contains an image and an object from a previous encounter at the space. Go ahead. And this is an image, an installation image. So you can see now it's a framed photograph in the space. Some of the original objects I was toying with made their way as well. Go to the next one. And that's another install image. So what was bad about this is that there was an apartment next door to the gallery. It had a fire the night after the opening, so the work was up for the opening, and then shut down. You go to the next slide. What was actually wonderful about it was that Art Pace, which is in San Antonio, has a residency program. One of their artists let me bring the work to Art Pace, and so I reinstalled it and brought with it, you go to the next slide, sort of the memories of the Solidea space, totally decontextualized. So these images were made specifically for that domestic space. They contain images of the domestic space. They made no sense in this exhibition space now, but it was like the challenge of trying to recontextualize all this work that had its home somewhere else and its genesis somewhere into a completely new environment. And this again was up for like 2 hours. So it was like all this kind of back and forth and driving and building and printing and re-photographing for these two-hour events, which I felt actually really wonderful about, as opposed to putting up an exhibition and letting it die for 6 weeks or not having it change. There was so much energy behind these two sort of one-night events. That's where they came out. So thank you.
Thriving mid-sized nonprofit organization who create and present it for the new round fans art program. It's our 15th anniversary. Over the last 14 years, we've supported over 500 trans and queer artists. Over two-thirds of them were people of color, and over two-thirds were trans and gender non-conforming. So I'm saying this because if you are a trans or queer artist or know folks, please talk to me. I want to know about you. So next slide. Oh, that was not the right slide, the first slide, now that I just look back, but that's okay. That was my email signature, that's okay. Let's go back one slide. So over the last 6 years, I've created a trilogy of evening-length videos that reveal aspects of buried or censored or forgotten aspects of transgender and queer history. This is the third in the trilogy of my newest work, which is The Missing Generation. It's now on a 2.5-3 year 20-city tour and is available for booking still. So The Missing Generation gives voice to transgender and LGBTQ longtime survivors of the early AIDS epidemic. And I created the work first by traveling across the US and recording oral history interviews with trans and queer longtime survivors of the early AIDS epidemic. Go to the next slide. I just actually, most of my slides are folks who are survivors because they're the part of the project. We'll just go through. This is A. Billy S. Jones in DC. We'll just go through these as I say each name. Next is Cheryl Courtney Evans in Atlanta, who's an amazing trans woman activist who just passed away in the last couple of months, who had been living with HIV for over 30 years. Next slide is the amazing Dee Dee Chambly in Atlanta. Next slide, Joe Izzo from DC. Next slide, Patricia Jones from Long Island, who estimated she lost about 1,000 people during the early epidemic that she worked with directly. Next slide, Kate Bornstein, the amazing trans activist. Next slide, Siobhan Egypt from New York. Next slide, Ron Swanda from DC, who's been living with HIV for over 30 years. And next slide, Joseph Minor Hill from Boston, who's been living with HIV since he was diagnosed in 84 when he was 14 years old. Next slide. So I did not set out to record 75 hours of oral history interviews, but I did, and then came home and spent over 500 hours integrating people's voices into a 17-section score, and then spent the next week choreographing the work with my dancers. I also want to give a shout out because this work was created with a very serious support and investment by a coalition of presenters in the NPN family, with support by the National Dance Project NEA, Beach Dance Festival, Dance Plays, Theater Offensive, Seven Stages in the Queer Cultural Center. I'm going to play a short little video clip. Please turn up the volume. Thank you so much.
Internet.
I can just chat for a little while. My 5 minutes is still. So internet is awaiting. Some of the images I'll show after the video is my own practice as a trans and queer activist and artist is to make work in deep relationship with communities and then to perform and tour the work in deep relationship with communities. So as we tour, I work in advance with each presenter or theater I'm working with.
I'm sure many of us have blocked out pieces of this I certainly know I have.
At a certain point, you're changed. I'm changed. Everyone I went through that has changed, just like people go through the war. You're changed.
Because 99.9% of trans people have never felt safe enough to set foot in a dance workshop, gym, or yoga studio. So these are some images, I think, Miss Pete, that's okay, of folks, Whitewater, Wisconsin, Fresno, Boston, and I are doing some workshops. Thank you so much.
Before I arrived at the residency, I wasn't sure what to do with this experiment, but when I saw the barn, this idea of this elusive image of a house, which refers to a home, comes to mind. So I created these drips, next slide please, to suspend in space to create this hovering image of a house. Next one, please. So here you can see that's where the pool wax was contacting the water, and it goes all the way down to a fine point as I lift it out of the water. Next one, please. So the fragility of the material speaks very much of the intent of the work. When you enter the space, people tend to slow down, they talk quieter. It's something that you cannot touch because the material will shatter in your hand even by a simple light touch. Next one, please. You can keep going. Next one. So I included a couple images of the installation for you to see the materiality and the fragility of the material. Next one, please. And next. So the next project I'd like to share with you is the Mending Project. I don't typically do performance projects, but this is one of the exceptions. This was from 2011, was on view at the Women at Work Gallery here in Austin. I suspended 15 pairs of Chinese scissors. These are iron scissors, they're quite sharp. They are not polite like the kind of scissors we use, but they're rounded tips. So I borrow a lot from my cultural background. I grew up in China. I also look at culture tradition of Chinese culture to get ideas and inspirations for my work. However, as an artist, my concern is more universal, but those things that's shared by different people, that's often overlooked. So the suspended scissors create this intense, menacing, very harsh energy above, and I wanted to sit under and sew. So let's go to the next slide. I think this was a time where there was the world financial crisis. There was a lot of worries and concerns. I was also looking at how we as a young parent, I also realize how it is our children versus this endless fear for everything. So in a way, I'm looking at all those things that we don't know how to address in life. Let's go to the next one. The issues, large or small, and how we may respond or counter perhaps to something small, simple, and persistent. So I thought the idea of sewing is such a familiar, comforting action, but it is also an action of healing, so that persistence perhaps could bring things, could bring about change. As I stitched these fabric together, they gain a strength they didn't have before, so they start to create these peaks and valleys that you see in the last slide. To create the topography, as they slowly expand in space, they counter that harsh energy above, resulting from the simple action. So at the entrance of the gallery, I hung a large sheet of white fabric. I invite the viewers to cut a small section to be passed on to me to be sewn onto the large field on the ground. Therefore, the viewers' thinking, thoughts, their energy is passed on and embedded into the work. Next one, please. And so, next slide. During the opening, I really enjoyed it in a way because this is the first time I don't have to talk to anyone. Oh, what else do you sew? So let's continue on. And the next project I want to show, again, this also was took place in Austin. This is the Ladybird Lake. People from Austin might remember this project. It's entitled Thirst. It's a large-scale collaborative project organized by Women Their Work Gallery. It was supported by a Robert Rauschenberg Foundation artistic collaboration grant. And I collaborated with three other women, two architects, Emily Little and Norma Yancey, and landscape architect, Cassie Bergstrom. So we cited this project in the heart of Austin, which is the Lady Bird Lake, and we're looking at the issue of drought. Since 2011, we had a multi-year drought that killed over 300 million trees. It's such a tremendous amount of number, it's impossible to even grasp or understand. So I decided to work with an image of one iconic tree that's affected by the drought. And the funny story was we can't use a dead tree. We have to use sort of a dying tree for the structure integrity. Let's go to the next one. The reason we chose Lady Bird Lake is also because it's a constant water level lake. It's such a privilege for us in Austin to have this lake where we have this constant water level, and downstream there's nothing in their riverbeds. And I think it's also a place because of that, we have our beautiful green belt. It's hard to realize we're actually in drought during the time we're working on this project, we're still in drought. And it was a project of a lifetime, really. We got to work with cranes, as you saw in the last one. We did surgery on the tree, so we embedded this very long metal pole into the tree. We painted it white using ecologically safe paint. Let's go to the next slide. And when on a barge, went down the river. This was a really wonderful time where we followed the tree all the way to the site. And we drilled a pipe into the bedrock of the Lady Bird Lake, 20 feet. So that's the part that we don't see. And then we also got to work with 18-wheeler to transport a tree. So that was fantastic. Let's keep going. So the tree went up, and it was on view for about 3 months. And because I usually work in my studio with my hands, this is also the one opportunity for me to stand back, to really rely on such a huge effort from the team and work with everyone else, to let go of control in a way. So at nighttime, the tree's illuminated, but until like 10:45 p.m. so that the lights turn off, the birds can go to sleep. And then during our drought, after the tree was up, there was a flood. Not once, but twice. Some people are nodding, you remember, and the entire team couldn't sleep overnight. We're like, oh my God, we hope the tree will stand. As you can see how high the water came up, if you're familiar with the site. And the tree stood. So that's the last slide. Nyawai Skinel, I am Rosie Seamus, Abino Shoni Anadawaga, Seneca Heron Clan. I would like to stand up here and talk about my work, but I don't think that that's actually going to be possible. So we'll say, oh, are you going to play the video? Okay. What I'd like to say is that my whole being is a protest, and that I exist against all odds. I'm a dance maker, but it's only a small part of what I actually do in this world. I have been working in the arts for 35 years. I'm also a teacher, sometimes I curate. I'm an organizer and an advocate, but mostly I'm a radical Native feminist. I come from a very long line of diplomats. My fifth great grandfather was a diplomat who negotiated with George Washington. And because of that, I spend part of every single day calling out inequity, racism, in a multitude of ways. So my work embodies this in every way that it possibly can. So I want to share with you first a video clip from a piece that just toured. Or maybe not. Yes, no? Okay, we can go to the slides. I'll talk just a little bit more. So this project, Skins, I will talk about this a little bit because it just opened. The last piece I toured in the US and Canada from 2014 to 2016 to black boxes in museums and large institutions. This piece, Skins, is sort of also a response to that. And I very particularly decided that I wanted to work with organizations that already had a relationship to the Native community to some degree. So it is a film, it's an exhibit, and it is a dance, which is actually just my personal expression of skin. The whole project really is to give visibility to the diversity of how Native people identify in the United States. We are over 567 recognized tribes. And many of us do live in urban areas. And so there is this whole inter-tribal cultural communities that have grown out of forced relocation, which began 70 years ago. And so I wanted to show this diversity in the many ways. And so really, like, creating a dance piece about that is absolutely ridiculous. But that's, you know, I have to say hello to that. And I would have to have a minimum of 567 people in the work in order to even begin to describe the diversity of Native identity. So what we did is created an exhibit, and this exhibit will be in different places. So the three main areas that I'm focused on are the Twin Cities in Minnesota, Chicago, and the San Francisco Bay Area. So we opened at Intermedia Arts in Minneapolis us and we took a small group to Riverside, California to be in Indigenous Contemporary Dance Symposium. And next we will be at the Pena in Berkeley, and we'll be at Eastside Arts in Oakland. We'll be working with the City of Chicago Cultural Center and Northwestern University and the Native American Studies and the English Department. As well, we will be at the American Indian Community Housing Organization in Duluth. So this is quite a different tour than the one before. And part of that is that I make my work for Native people. I don't make my work for other people. But it doesn't mean that everybody is not invited. Where's my time? I don't know what time we have.
You have less than 1 minute.
Okay. So that seems to turn off a lot of people, but what I'm trying to do is create an authentic connection between me and the community and other people. And so rather than non-Native people coming to my work and having a voyeuristic experience, wanting to have a Native experience, which in a way they're having, but they're doing it by watching me communicate to my own people. You don't have to show me. This is just a small video for spins. I'll say one more little quick thing while this is still running. So we are all visitors on unceded Native American territory, right? So if you want to make a difference, what you can do is you can curate, you can fund, you can see, and you can learn about Native artists in your community. Thank you.
I wanted that sort of layered experience that with the distance of beckoning public art piece that I completed this year, 2016. I was part of a larger project that was called Drawing Lines, and it was about a response to Austin's new change from at-large representation to geographic representation. So it was divided into 10 different districts, and the idea was that artists would be embedded within each district to kind of make a piece with the community and for the community. So this was my contribution to that. It was called Wish Lantern Bridge, and I went into the community and worked with schools, community centers, and I made origami lanterns with them, each person, and I asked each person to write a wish of their own on each piece of paper before we folded it, and then when we folded it and glued the wish in together, it was kind of this tangible wish. Mm-hmm. And then I struck, I'm sorry?
1 minute.
Oh, okay, I'll go a little faster. And then I, sorry, I asked the community to come together to do a ceremony, and then we lit the bridge together, so it was this one large collective wish. And we did like a walking meditation to kind of think about all of our wishes with each other. And the last piece I wanted to show was public artwork that's up right now. It's to benefit the Austin Animal Center. And it's made of 1,800 of the Japanese lucky cats. And each meant to represent 1/10 of the 18,000 animals that the shelter serves per year. And each one is available for adoption, and all those funds go directly to the center to benefit their adoption services. So, thank you.
Okay, we're actually going to quick pause.
Sorry,
love it.
To do another art burst, and then we'll get back to jamming some slides. So, but to introduce our next artist, please welcome Neil Barclay from the Contemporary Arts Center of New Orleans.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. So you all don't go to Baptist churches. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Another time. Kay Pearl is the our next Artburst artist. We had the pleasure of working with Katie on an interdisciplinary, I should stand up here, work called How to Build a Forest. And How to Build a Forest actually takes place over 8 hours. It's an installation during a durational installation piece where the artist literally, Sean Hall, Katie, and Lisa DeMoor actually build a forest in our raw warehouse space and then destroy it by the end of the 8-hour circuit. So Katie is one half of that performance team of Pearl DeMoor. It's an interdisciplinary company she shares with playwright Lisa DeMoor. Apart from Pearl DeMoor, she makes her own individual work as a playwright, director, and performer. And today she's gonna show a sliver of a work, a show in development called Okay, Okay. There's a second, there's an exclamation point after the second, okay. An intimate performance of objects about looking for home by putting down roots in a home state you were raised to reject. By the way, she is looking for homes to workshop the next draft of this piece. You can check out her brand new website at katiepearl.com and let her know what you think.
Sometimes called the buckle of the Bible belt. A recent and
depression, and rage, turning her into our own family's dragon, complete with fire and a chain around her neck that kept her tethered, unfortunately, to Oklahoma. Carrie Underwood is from Oklahoma. She is a singing superstar sensation. And Tanya Harding, that ice skater, the other ice skater, I think she's from Oklahoma. I could be wrong. But we are not from Oklahoma. We are not allowed to pronounce Tulsa, Telsa, or milk, milk. And the dragon that was my mother continued to breathe fire at whoever was unfortunate enough to cross her path at the wrong time, for example, any night after 8 p.m. So, it is night. It's another night. My sister is watching MASH reruns in the TV room, and I am 10 again. I am still 10. I have lived my entire 10 years with exuberant body hair growth. My arms are hairy, my legs are hairy, black hair, it's not pretty. I am practically the only white girl with black hair in my entire school. Practically every white girl in Oklahoma is blonde, but me and my hairy legs are not blonde. There is a razor in my mother's bathtub, and I decide to use it. Look at that. Look at how smooth and clean this looks. This is like magic. I shave both legs, no soap, just water. I test a patch on my arm, but it is too much. The change is too overwhelmingly beautiful. I picture myself walking into the cafeteria with shaved arms. I don't want anyone to know that I shaved. I just want to show up beautiful as them. I stick to my legs, I do a good job, I go to bed. My mom gets home from her night class teaching humanities at Tulsa Junior College. This is the legendary class where she tells her students that no one really knows what Jesus said. Not really. One girl raises her hand and says, "Oh no, Mrs. Pearl, in our church we do know what Jesus said." So my mom says, "How in your church do you know what Jesus said?" And the girl says, "Because in my church, what Jesus said is printed in red." My mom gets home. She goes into the bathroom and sees the bathtub, which is now covered in hair, my leg hair, which it didn't occur to me to wash out. She asks my sister, who is still watching TV, whether my sister had taken a bath earlier that night. My sister said no, but I had taken a bath. My mom knows what happened. I can hear her coming up the stairs. Step, step, step. And there is a dragon at my bedroom door. I freeze in my bed, I pretend to be sleeping. I can see her dragon shape silhouetted in the hallway. The hallway light makes a halo. I freeze in my bed, I try to get smaller. "Katie," the dragon says, "I know you're awake, Katie." I say, "Nothing. I am frozen, I am not breathing, she will not sniff me out." "Did you shave your legs tonight?" The dragon is asking a question. "Downstairs in the tub, did you shave your legs tonight?" "No," I say. "No," she says. "I am lying." I am lying to her. I am lying in my bed, toes clenched, voice calm. I am not getting smaller. I am getting bigger. I am a big, chunky, lying mass of girl. I cannot hide any more than I am hiding. "Are you lying to me?" "No, Mommy. My bedroom is filling with smoke, channels of steam coming from the dragon's nostrils. Are you telling me that if I were to turn on this light and walk over to that bed and pull down the covers, I would see that you had not shaved your legs tonight?" panhandles, the sky would go dark in the middle of the day, totally dark, midnight at noon, they called them, black blizzards. People would lose their way at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, get lost, totally lost, just between their fences and their front doors. Thank you.
History, we told a lot of stories about anti-black violence in order to get at the root of just seeing what was going on and realizing what was going on. Next slide. Our most recent work is called The Mikado Reclaimed, and we did we used the Mikado, which some of you might know, yellow face racist thing, and we took an all Asian American cast to tell a story about internment in the near future, which at that point in time felt really far away, but doesn't so much anymore. Next slide. Because I want to remind us that Korematsu v. U.S., which enabled our state to incarcerate upwards of 100,000 Japanese Americans, is still considered good law. This is the last slide, but I'll just talk about our next piece, which is will be a devised piece called Scheherazade, with a mostly Middle Eastern, actually mostly untrained cast, where we're going to look at anti-Muslim sentiment as well as displacement and violence. And I just want to say that being in Texas and producing this work is hard. But now I feel like we have the rest of the country to look towards because it's going to be hard for all of us. And so I'm so honored. Thank you so much for letting me talk about our work. And I'm so honored to be able to present with everybody else. Thank you.
Materials with meanings that are unintended by the original makers. And so I kind of spend a lot of my time just looking for materials, whether that means spending hours and hours looking through YouTube videos or going for walks or finding materials on eBay. And then it's really about sort of creating a relationship between the materials that I find. I'm really interested in materials that are psychologically or culturally loaded and pairing materials that are sort of more complicated or ask some questions when they're put in relationship with one another. So this first piece is called Advantage, and essentially I made it while I was a resident at a space in Miami, and at the time I only had access to a bike, and all I brought with me in terms of materials were like a stack of books and a camera, so I only worked with things that I could either carry by walking or carry on the bike. And so someone had freshly cut a palm tree in their front yard, and so I ended up using that as a part of this piece. And then I found a Wilson basketball in the residency. If you can go to the next slide. And the piece is called Advantage. And I think, you know, it's a lot of my work is about tension. I think it was Gertrude Stein that said that there's tension in everything that's worthwhile. And in this particular piece, it's not only the subject of the work, but also the materials, the way that they're sort of resting upon one another, and this sort of pipe that's going through the spaces also becomes a part of the work. If we could go to the next slide. And if you could pause this before the sound plays. So this is actually a sound installation. It was recently up at Blue Star Contemporary in San Antonio. And this piece is called Everybody's Got a Hungry Heart, American Skin. And essentially, it consists of several hours of content of people who have material I found online of people who are rubbing their bodies with microphones. And what's interesting, they're doing it one at a time. What's kind of interesting is that it doesn't sound like it's like something that a single person would produce. It's very sort of celestial in nature. So anyways, it's a compilation of people rubbing their bodies with microphones. So if you guys want to hear that, Rachel.
Thank you.
Or you can check out my website, www.lizarada.com. Okay, so the next piece, so I do work primarily with video, and a lot of what I'm doing is finding video and then getting audio from a disparate source, and then creating some kind of a tension, some kind of a relationship between this disparate material. So actually the next two video clips are going to be part of a solo exhibition I have coming up with Women and Their Work, and I know that some of you guys are here in late January, if any of you guys are in Austin. So this piece is called First Freedom, and it's just a short excerpt from it.
Let's focus on letting go.
So I guess another thing to say about my practice is I get a lot of material off of YouTube, and I've really tried not to shy away from what source material brings me. And when I am looking for material that I'm going to work with, I don't have any sort of agenda that I'm sort of consciously aware of. I'm really looking for stuff that I'm drawn to, and then it's about kind of figuring out what my relationship is to that material and commenting on it in some capacity. And so this particular video I'm just going to show you, again, a short excerpt from, is called Zoom Test, and it's the result of doing an online search of Zoom test videos where people test the Zoom function on their camera to see, you know, like how robust and smooth and like amazing their camera quality is. But this one was different. And then I responded to it with a piece of audio. That's an audio translation of a text by the philosopher Judy Krishnamurti. If you want to play this clip, yeah.
In all our relationships, each one of us builds an image about the other, and these two images have relationship. The actual relationship between two human beings, or between many human beings, completely ends when there is the formation of images. It seems to me that one of our greatest difficulties is to see for ourselves really clearly. When we say we see a tree, or a flower, or a person, do we actually see them? Or do we merely see the image that the word has created?
So that's a short excerpt from a much longer piece. But that's all I have. This is a project entitled Sightlines that was at Art Peace in San Antonio. And I think in a general way, I'm interested in phenomenological aspects of sort of photographic language. I'm seduced by photography, and I'm also repelled by it. This work was inspired by spending a lot of time out in West Texas and looking at the idiosyncratic qualities of light. In color, I was taking unfixed pieces of photographs and unrolling them out in the landscape and watching basically the paper fade. So the paper should have been used in a dark room, but I was sort of doing the opposite. And I got really interested, you can go to the next one, in the folds, the marks of the hand, the sort of gestures and indentations from
I think you go to the next one. And I think one of the things that I was learning about was these kind of image object questions with photographs, and specific in that there's an experience through the surface as much as there is through the pictorial one. You can go to the next one. And so in the show, I paired this sort of suite of photographs with these glass panels in a kind of sculptural installation that were reliant on the light in the space to transition them. So they were ephemeral in effect, in that the viewer could go at a certain time of day and could potentially see this artificial light reflecting this, but as the gallery space filled with light, sometimes it was omitted or erased because of the brightness. Go to the next one. And whereas in the opposite corner, that one would transition in color sometimes depending on the viewer's position. And so I'm always interested in the ways that our body and the space of our body can recontextualize our experience with a picture. And so I thought about the glass panels as a live photograph or this kind of unfixed idea of a picture. Okay. And then the third component in the project, I also work in video, was a video project called Tower of the Americas. A lot of my research has to do with histories of observation, and one of the things that I've been researching are observation towers, and specifically ones that are linked to the World's Fair. So San Antonio, if you could go back, thanks. So San Antonio was part of the 1968 World's Fair, and one of the things about these towers is this panoptical experience when you're looking over at the horizon line that is linked to the camera. And so the video is an hour long, and it's filmed from the rotating restaurant, which many of these towers boast. And so the focus is actually on the glass, which felt imperative and also shared a dialectic with this relationship with the photograph, the surface, and the pictorial. And it circled around 360 degrees, so it was the full rotation of the 360 degree architecture. Okay. And then the last project is from last year, and it's a project called Local Time. And I went to Dubai to film from what's marketed as the tallest observation tower in the world. And okay, and so one of the things that I learned about this space was sort of similar in thinking about the physics of the glass, the engineering and the design, and how people could encounter the view. And I was very invested in the reflections. Go to the next one. And one of the things that happened that felt similar to West Texas, actually, was that there were these optical illusionistic experiences with the atmosphere of color, part of which had to do with these sandstorms, which are very common there, and also the heat index, which was about 125 degrees. And so that, with the glass and this very climate-controlled interior, created this doubling of the suns, which I'm not sure if you can actually see in the slide, but so there's a suite of images that I made where you're seeing two suns, and that vantage mostly composed of me just moving panel to experience that. And that's it.
I'm Kristen. I'm going to talk about one project. It's called Dance with Flamingos. And it's an augmented reality sculpture park that has undergone two different iterations, one in Gainesville, Florida, and another at the Queens Museum in the Flushing Meadows Corona Park, former site of the 1964 World's Fair in New York City. It's a project in which I collaborated with, over the two iterations, 20 different artists who I wrote a contextual framework for the show, and then I helped technically produce their augmented aspect of their work, and all of the artists work in some form of 3D, and they're very different generations of artists. Next slide. to experience the exhibition, the visitors would download an app to their phone, and then it was a free augmented reality app, and then tap on their screen while looking at a postcard of a flamingo that was on a garden stake. This was the way I was able to present it in Florida, but in New York you can't really have garden stakes in the park, or something terrible could happen. So they're a little different in each place. And in the exhibition, the flamingo acts as an ambassador and concierge to the project, both the consummate showman and the embattled victim of environmental neglect and habitat destruction. It is the act of scanning the image of this paradoxical bird that launches the augmented reality exhibition. And worth noting also is that in Florida, there are images of flamingos everywhere. But the bird has actually gone missing in the wild for over 100 years. The conservation efforts have meant that in the last couple of years, there have been a few more wild flamingos returning to the Everglades. However, at this point in our global situation of industry, the situation of flamingo is worse than ever, and they have a very fragile habitat. So this project is very much using the flamingo to launch into a larger conversation about culture and industry, social issues, climate change, things like that. Drawing parallels between the phantom presence, and we can go to the next slide, between the phantom presence of augmented reality and equally intangible notions of the future, given this rapid progression of technological and environmental change. I prompted each artist to create a virtual work envisioning the future of land art and land use, and everybody was kind of able to approach it in their own way, and they would write a description, and people would interact with these augments, and they would, can you stop at that slide, thanks? And then they would interact with them, and sometimes share them over social media and stuff like that. I was interested in digital tools and their ability to create even physically impossible scenarios that weren't linked to budget restrictions and things, and explore new realities, ideas of new realities. Next slide. Let's see. I'll tell you a little bit about some of them. This is Will Pappenheimer's Florida Rushmore, and it's a palatial-sized mountain sculpture, a virtual Florida adaptation of the presidential monument in South Dakota. The bedrock for the monument consists of an upside-down imprint of the Devil's Millhopper sinkhole. There's sinkholes that are kind of naturally occurring and also accelerated due to industry in Florida. And so he sort of turned it into a melting polar ice, or an inverse of a sinkhole into a melting polar ice cap made out of Ocala limestone. So he's referencing a lot of these things about the local environment and creating this new monument. I'm going to keep moving on the next slide. This is a map from the Queen's iteration where you just have this one image to scan. There's a list of artists on the backside. There's,
1 minute.
Thank you. There are works within the museum and also all around the grounds. Next slide. This is Alfredo Salazar Caro's piece called Father. Next slide. This is Lillian Hongli's Shadow Play Sinking, and it depicts the cultural and environmental degradation brought on by rapid urbanization in China over the past few decades. Next slide. And this is Mauricio Aliari's Dark Matter. This piece is based on a series of combined sculptural objects put together to form humorous juxtapositions. The objects chosen for this series are the objects of things that have been banned or taboo in Iran, China, Saudi Arabia, and North Korea due to religious and political reasons. And I also put one, a geolocated one to the for her to Tehran at the Ministry of Culture and Islamic Guidance. Next, and I'll just show you a few images. Next, there's another copy of this at NASA. The artist suggested this is a former swamp, and these are all animated, you just can't really tell. Next. And this, the last one that I'll tell you about is a piece by, this is a piece by, I don't have it here, Tabita Rizier, and it's a tribute to black women who have given their bodies to medical science, in particular the hysterectomy, and she's kind of created this monument
to their bodies. And there's another one that's geolocated at Central Park in front of a large sculpture. It's a statue that is attributed to the father of gynecology, who is notorious for using women's bodies in science in this way, particularly black women's bodies. So that's just a taste.
We perform neo-spirituals, which are a cappella musicals that are descendants of Negro spirituals and a blend of black aesthetics from the blues, jazz, R&B, soul, spoken word, hip hop, all that, using a methodology that I call soul work, which is created from African-American performance traditions and aesthetics. My work typically spans and straddles time to place history in conversation with its systemic, cultural, and social descendants. The piece we are currently touring and that is still open for bookings is called The Burn-In. It's a project funded by the NMPN Creation Fund grant, co-commissioned by Junebug Productions and the NEFA National Theater Project grant. The Burn-In simultaneously examines two nightclub fires, one in 1940s Mississippi, the other in 2003 Chicago, both of them among the top nightclub tragedies in US history. While researching the burn-in in Mississippi, it became necessary to engage the early days of plantation tourism in order to contextualize the story of the over 300 African Americans who perished in the 1940s fire. When my company got the opportunity to rehearse on the grounds of a plantation in Mississippi, I knew that my next piece was being born. It's called Plantation Remix. The idea for Plantation Remix began with the question, what is an appropriate afterlife for America's historic slavery plantation? At the time, I was a professor at Prairie View A&M University, a former plantation that was converted in 1867 to a historically black college that still thrives today. But the majority of retired plantations cannot boast such a reincarnation. Many plantations became and remain prisons in their next lives. Angola State Prison, one of the most notorious plantation to prison pipelines. Other sites like Monticello are preserved as historic monuments. Others are sites of romanticized reenactments of antebellum glory and hoop skirts, ball gowns, and Confederate soldiers, absent, of course, the realities of slavery. And others are wedding destinations. Some have become master planned residential communities. We got a lot of those in Houston. Plantation Remix will be a site-specific neo-spiritual and performance that gives a tour of historical U.S. plantations, and it's designed to rehabilitate, remix, and reimagine the afterlife of plantations as functional sites that contribute to contemporary anti-racism work and America's need for ongoing dialogue, healing, and progress on race. You can go to the video. This excerpted opening scene for The Burn-In presents a reimagined plantation tour while integrating and interrogating it, rejecting a single story of U.S. history through a multi-perspective visual and sonic interpretation of the tour's unspoken layers of contrasting experiences, visibility, invisibility, stereotype, silence, privilege, and power. The clip, it's about 3 minutes, was presented, this particular clip was presented at the First Congregational Church in Atlanta, which was established in 1867 and is known for its historical connections to abolition and efforts to educate recently freed African Americans after the Civil War. So this clip captures an early workshop attempt by my company to remix a historic site as a physical and symbolic backdrop using the play's performance, this plantation tour performance, and themes as the mode of analysis for the space and for historical context.
Have you never seen the sunset? Okay, we don't have, really have time for a conversation, but if everyone can just put their hands together, and thank you so much, all of you guys.